since you are interested in diplomacy and what's happening in India at this moment, that I'll give you a very brief account of what the situation today is, and then we can go into greater detail as you may want to know what exactly are the implications of the changes in foreign policy and the advent of the Modi administration. One thing I must say right from the beginning is that foreign policy changes very little with the changes of governments, because foreign policy of India has remained largely unchanged since Pandit Nehru's time. And that is basically because it was Pandit Nehru who made our foreign policy. And this foreign policy was very simple. He said that at the middle of the night of 15th August or 14th August, before 15th broke. So he said it in one sentence, what India's foreign policy is. He said, India looks at the world with clear and friendly eyes. That's all. That is the essence of our foreign policy. We look at the world with clear and friendly eyes. Friendly, yes. Everybody says, every leader will say he wants to be friendly with the world. But he also used the word clear. What does that mean? That means we know what is going on around us. We will have clear ideas as to what the world is like. So our friendliness is in a way tempered by our clarity of thinking. And that exactly has been the foreign policy of India, regardless of the changes in the government. But every country will say that we are friendly. Every country will say that we want to be friendly with all nations of the world. But India had very little choice at the time of our independence, as you all know. When India became independent, what choice did we have? Did we have a choice of having a dictatorship or a democracy? We did not have. Because India is basically a democratic country. We have had democracy for centuries, even before the British ever came here. You know, the Panchayati Raj and the village courts and so on. So democracy is not alien to us, and we could not have had any other form of government except democracy. And you know what happened when Mrs. Gandhi experimented with dictatorship for a little while. We threw her out and of course brought her back when she declared elections again. So India's soul is democratic. Similarly, India's soul was also non-aligned, because we could not have, even if Panditji wanted it, he could not have taken India to the Western Alliance or the NATO or CETO or CENTO or whatever alliances existed at that time. Because we have just broken out of the colonial yoke after years of, more than 100 years of struggle. So how could India be part of a Western Alliance? We could not be. Similarly, we could not be part of the communist states, because we are hardly even communist, we are a democratic nation. And therefore, the choice was very limited for Panditji as a leader of India. He had to be non-aligned, though the word non-aligned did not exist at that time. He consciously decided not to be part of either the Western Alliance or the Eastern Alliance. And so this idea of a non-aligned movement came about. That came about only in 1962. But Panditji and India were practicing that all through. And what is the essence of non-aligned? There's a lot of misunderstanding about it. Because people say, if you are non-aligned now, what does it mean? There's nobody to be aligned with. Right? That is the feeling. Two blocks have disappeared. So what is the question of alignment? But that is not the meaning. The meaning of non-alignment means that you have freedom of action and independence of judgment in what you do. What you do is not dictated by others. That's all that it means. It may happen that in the pursuit of that policy, you may be siding with the West on occasions, you may be siding with the East on occasions, you may not side with either of them on occasions. And so the idea was not that you are not aligned to the East or the West, that we decide on our foreign policy or we decide on our actions entirely by our own judgment and not because you are forced or persuaded by any major power. And that has been our policy all through. I do not want to go into each of those decisions, but one aspect I must mention, that in spite of that, there was a misunderstanding in the whole world, as it were, that we are leaning towards the Soviet Union. And that was a historical accident, in the sense that several things that we needed at that particular time for India's economic development, you must all be familiar with that, came from the Soviet Union, not from the United States. Of course, the United States also cooperated in the building of the IITs and various other things. But the fundamental industrial development of India, the need, the resources for it and the technology for it came from the Soviet Union rather than from the United States. But that was not ideological. That is the point I want to stress. We depended on the Soviet Union for certain things, not because of any ideology, but because of practical reasons. Like, for example, our products, our consumer goods would not be purchased by the United States. We did not have the quality. But the Soviet Union was willing to buy your Panama cigarettes or Louisiana sweaters because that's the kind of standard level they had. They were not sophisticated enough. So we were able to export our sweaters and cigarettes, etc., only to the Soviet Union, not to the Western countries. And in exchange, we got durable goods, industrial engineering goods, we got weapons. So virtually we had a rupee arrangement with the Soviet Union. We did not need foreign exchange to buy things from the Soviet Union. So for that reason, not because of any ideological reason, India may have leaned towards the Soviet Union in our economic activities. But on the political side, we never sided with the Soviet Union. Though there may be several issues on which Soviet Union and us, we thought alike. Take, for example, Palestine or apartheid or any of those global issues on which we had a particular point of view, which happened to be or coincided with the perspective of the Soviet Union. And therefore, the misunderstanding that India was a Soviet satellite was wrong. Or even if we were more friendly to the Soviet Union, that was basically because of the economic compulsions and accident of certain positions that we took in the international community. So that was the situation till the end of the Cold War. Of course, when the Cold War ended, the situation changed dramatically. There was no Soviet Union. Soviet Union broke up. And the only superpower in the world became the United States. And everybody in the world wanted to be more friendly to the United States because it had become a unipolar world. There's only one pole for the world now, not a bipolar world. And therefore, there was very little choice for the rest of the world to be part of a system which was dominated by the United States. So many things changed, and the world started revolving around the United States. But even at that time, say between 1990 to 2000, so 2000 or so, when Soviet United States was the only superpower and there was nobody else to challenge it, India did not align itself with the United States. Our relations with the United States improved because the United States felt that we were no more a Soviet satellite, and so they were willing to cooperate with us. Our financial situation improved and we could use foreign exchange to buy our goods. We didn't have to depend on a rupee arrangement. We became self-sufficient in food grains, which is a very important point. You cannot have a foreign policy, independent foreign policy, if you have to wait for shipments of wheat from the United States. So all these dramatically changed our situation. But what did not change during this whole period was our decision that we stick to our own positions independent of other influences. And that has now replaced where we now don't talk about non-alignment, we now talk about strategic autonomy. So in all that we do in our foreign policy, we can discuss individual cases, but we maintain the position that we have our strategic autonomy to decide on whatever issue that comes up with our own strategy thinking. And this of course was misunderstood by some, appreciated by some. Non-aligned movement itself is no more a strong international force. So we do not have a non-aligned movement which had 113 members. So there was a certain amount of trade unionism there. The developing countries were together. And that broke up because of the disappearance of the Soviet bloc. Because there was nobody to support you or nobody you could exploit one against the other that was possible earlier. So, but India being a big country and our economic status improved after the liberalization of the economy. So we were able to maintain this throughout. So even today, when we choose one or the other, or when we choose to join one group or the other, we have increasingly become conscious of what is called enlightened self-interest. And therefore, we are not shy to be associated or linked with a particular group or a regional grouping. So today we are members of several regional groups, starting with SAARC. SAARC itself is a South Asian regional organization. We were not ready for SAARC when it was originally proposed, because Mrs. Gandhi at that time felt that our neighbors will gang up against us. They will want to exploit India's size and economic strength, and we have problems with each of our neighbors for one way or the other, which we did not create those situations. But in spite of us, those problems arose. And therefore, we were not very comfortable with SAARC. But we accepted SAARC. SAARC did not become a strong regional organization because of contradictions on the South Asian subcontinent. But still, we are now very active. We are working very close with ASEAN, as you know, in the Southeast Asian countries. We are not part of ASEAN because geographically we are not from the region, but we have very close association with ASEAN. We have, of course, you have heard about BRICS, the Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa organization, which has recently set up even a bank to counter the World Bank and the IMF. And then you cannot think of a more disparate group than that. What does Brazil to do with South Africa? What does Russia to do with China? What does India to do with any of these? But it was invented by an American economist, as you may remember. There was a gentleman with Goldman Sachs who said there are these five countries who seem to have similar economic characteristics, because they are all big countries, they are developing countries, though Soviet Union was already a superpower, Russia is now considered a developing country. China, almost a superpower, but still thinks it is a developing country. Brazil is a huge, huge country. India is. And they're all so-called emerging economies. So this was just an observation made by an American economist, which I think sets people thinking that if these five countries, then they get together, can't they do something for the world? And that is how BRICS was born. There are many contradictions there. Of course, IPSA. Within BRICS itself, we have an organization called IPSA, that is India, Brazil, and South Africa. The developing countries within BRICS, which has become rather unimportant now because BRICS has grown into an alternative to G20 or G8 at least. So that kind of complexity has arisen. So in other words, to put it very briefly, we are now interested more in selective alignments rather than non-alignment. We don't say so, but if you look at India's present posture in the world, you will find that we have not shied away from making alignments. I'm not talking about military alliances, but wherever we are able to find common grounds within a country, we have not hesitated to work with it. For example, China is considered India's number one enemy, at least many people consider China to be an enemy of India. I personally feel that there is a considerable threat from China today or tomorrow. There are others who believe that China is not a threat to India, whatever it may be. But I have no evidence to show that China will ever be friendly to us. It will be an adversarial relationship for the future, whether we settle the border or not. But in spite of that, we work with China on certain issues which we consider common, like for example trade issues, because vis-a-vis the Western markets, India has a lot of interest. I mean, you yourself must be aware of the problems that we have in trade, because they want our markets, but they don't want to open their markets for us, and that is unequal trade, unjust trade. Similarly, they don't allow us to subsidize our farmers or subsidize our traders, and that's a big issue between us. As you know, WTO India is holding up an agreement on trade and customs, which of course was being discussed in Delhi with Kerry, and probably in the next 24 hours we may hear that India has probably made some concessions, I don't know. But if we don't do that, if we do not sign that agreement, then the whole world will turn against you, as they did in the case of our nuclear non-proliferation treaty. India, Pakistan, and Israel are the only three countries which have not signed the NPT. And so the world looks at us with suspicion, but as though we are very aggressive on nuclear issues. So a similar position will come if we do not sign the WTO agreement. But I suspect that something will happen because it's difficult for India to isolate itself from the rest of the world on an issue like that. And I personally believe that John Kerry came here in a great hurry, basically because of this particular problem between India and the rest of the world. So today, by this evening, we'll probably know what the relationship will be as far as US is concerned. So coming to our relations with the US, I always compare it with a roller coaster ride. I'm sure all of you have been on roller coasters. So you know what happens. It goes up very, very slowly all the way, struggling as it were. And then once it reaches the top, it falls. And when it falls, your heart comes to your mouth, don't you? When you are in a roller coaster. And it falls all the way down. And then you think it's the end of the world. Then you will not think that you'll survive as you go down. Then you find yourself surviving and you're there. And then the roller coaster again starts climbing up. So India-US relations, as I have observed in the last 30 years or so, 10 years within the United States, I must say that this roller coaster ride has continued for a long time. In the Cold War days, of course, it was down in the dumps, and after the Cold War, it started picking up, and it reached a certain height at the time of President Clinton in the second term. President Clinton made a determined effort to remove the difficulties in India-US relations. And he tried very hard. And in fact, he was planning to come to India in early 1998, to visit India, to start a new age in India-US relations. But lo and behold, we had the nuclear test on 11th May 1998, a day I can never forget, because I was in Washington and I faced the music of the consequences of that. And so the roller coaster was absolutely down to the earth, because the United States felt that India had committed a crime, and the only thing they could offer us was some kind of punishment. So I personally can tell you what the days were like on the 11th of May. We would go to the Foreign Office, sit across the table and say nothing. Can you imagine diplomats looking at each other and not saying anything? Because the Americans felt that what we had done was absolutely wrong. We destroyed the whole edifice of nuclear non-proliferation. And so the only option they gave us was the punishment that you would like to take. They said, since we are friendly people, we can either hang you, shoot you, or drown you, you can choose. That was the only option they gave us. We told them that, no, we would like to talk to you. We would like to explain to you. They said, no, we don't want any explanation. And it went on for about 14 days. Every day I would go to the Foreign Office, look at each other, old friends of ours, but saying nothing, because Americans did not want any conversation on what had happened. They said, you sign the NPT today and the CTBT tomorrow, then we'll be friends, otherwise, no. And there was panic in the Indian community in the US at that time, May 1998. Dr. Chidambaram was not given even a visa to visit the United States, to attend a crystallographic conference, nothing to do with nuclear energy. Many scientists were expelled under some pretext or the other from the sensitive establishments in United States. And the very essential equipment that we needed, small things that we needed for our nuclear program and our space program, could not be purchased from the market. In fact, I must confess that we actually smuggled them through the diplomatic bag in order to make our nuclear industry going. That was the kind of situation there was. And I didn't think that there could be any kind of progress in the next couple of years. But of all people, somebody who came to our rescue at that time was an India hater, the one who wanted to declare war against India in 1971, Dr. Henry Kissinger. Because Henry Kissinger, in the middle of all this, and there was so much tension, and the Democrats were screaming at us, Henry Kissinger just said one sentence. He said, I understand India, because India lives in a tough neighborhood. That's all that he said, just one sentence. And that changed the atmosphere in the United States, out of the blue. Because the Republicans understood what he was saying. Democrats did not understand it very well. But when he said India lives in a tough neighborhood, that is something which Americans understand. You must have been in the United States, many of you. Every glamorous city has a tough neighborhood. If you have been to New York, you must have seen Harlem. Nobody goes to Harlem without a gun in your pocket, because otherwise you are not likely to come back. So up to the 196th Street in Manhattan, it is safe, but 197th Street, you are dead before you reach there. And that is what a tough neighborhood means. And that is true of India's neighborhood. Because you have two nuclear weapon states, China and Pakistan, who have fought wars against you and you have problems with you every day. And we have another six or seven states who are never at peace with us, because they're always complaining left and right that India has been exploiting, India is a bully, India is unreasonable, irrational, all that. Though I personally feel that our neighborhood policy has never been cruel, we have never been unsympathetic to the requirements of our neighbors. We have made unilateral concessions all the time. We gave away Kachathivu to the Sri Lankans, we gave away Deen Bighar to the Bangladeshis, we have built LTTE at one time in Sri Lanka, then we got LTTE killed, we went, Indian soldiers went in there and got killed themselves. So there is nothing that we have not tried in order to solve the problems of our neighbors. But still, the impression around the world and among our neighbors is that India is a bully and should be controlled. So when Kissinger said that India is in a tough neighborhood, people realized that yes, what India had done was in order to secure itself from the threat from Pakistan and China. Not as much from Pakistan, because Pakistan we can deal with even without nuclear weapons. How many wars have we fought? We have won it each time. But China is not like that. China, of course, 1962, all of you know how horrible it was. But even in the future, if there is a confrontation between China and India, there is no way we can win. Whether it is a traditional war or a nuclear war, India cannot win. So that is the kind of situation, and that changed the atmosphere in the US, because the US also, all said and done, is rather worried about China. If 20 to 30 years from now, China becomes even more powerful than China, than the United States, and if there is a confrontation, who is it that the United States can rely upon in Asia, other than India? But the only democracy in Asia is India. So that is what led to what we now understand as the nuclear deal, which Dr. Manmohan Singh and Bush signed in 2005. So the roller coaster actually went up again in Bush's days, 2005, and when we signed it in 2008 and 2010, President Obama came to India, everything was beautiful. So we were on top of the roller coaster. And then dramatically it fell down again, because we decided to adopt in Parliament what is called a Nuclear Liability Act. I'm sure you are familiar with that. On the one hand, we signed the nuclear deal with the United States. We promised them that we will buy $10 billion worth of nuclear reactors from them. And then we passed a bill which is totally against the international law about liability. Because according to international law, when you have a deal, a nuclear deal or a nuclear reactor deal, then the responsibility, if there is an accident, is that only of the operator, not the supplier. It's like you buy a car. When you buy a car, once you buy the car and the guarantees are protected, if you go and kill somebody or you crash the car somewhere, can you go and blame the supplier? The Mercedes company is not going to be responsible for what you do with your car once it is sold to you. This is the international law. This is international law relating to reactors also, strangely enough. So when a reactor is sold to you, if there is a disaster, because a disaster with a nuclear reactor can be, you know, maybe you'll all turn into monkeys or something like that may happen. So therefore the disaster can be very, very, very damaging and destructive. And then who will compensate you for that? So the Indian Parliament decided against the international law that we will buy nuclear reactors from other countries only if the supplier is held responsible. And this is totally against the domestic laws of the United States. So that is where the roller coaster started falling. Because they said that we gave you the nuclear deal, you told us that you will buy equipment, but you have made life miserable for us because we cannot sell you equipment. Because under our laws, no American company will be able to sell reactors to you. So you may ask then, how did we buy from France and Russia? Because France and Russia also have the same problem. But France and Russia, the operators or the suppliers are government agencies, French agencies and Russian agencies, who can take a risk. So they are taking a risk by supplying Kodungulam to us. And if tomorrow Kodungulam bursts, Russia will have to compensate us for that. So, but they say that this is only a temporary phase and they would also like this law to be removed according to international law. So that started the problems with the United States again, and to which we added a number of, we added some, they added some, and by the time Devyani Corporate was arrested and searched, we had reached the bottom of the roller coaster. And that is where Mr. Modi has come and taken over the reins of India. And of course, Mr. Modi has another problem because his visa was revoked by the US government. And only yesterday, Mr. John Kerry gave a clue as to how they want to resolve it, because he said the government which revoked Mr. Modi's visa was a different government, he said. So he's trying to find a way out of it. He says it was not Obama, maybe it was Clinton. And this is the first time he has said it. So far they never said that. They kept saying Mr. Modi is very welcome to the United States, but said nothing about visa. They said we'll give him a diplomatic visa, after all he is a prime minister. But once he ceases to be prime minister, can he visit the United States again? We don't know. And therefore, there is a basic problem between the prime minister and the United States. But the prime minister has been very quiet about it. He has not said a word about his visa till today. Not during the election, not during, even after he became prime minister, everybody is talking about the visa, but he doesn't say anything. And of course, now the complaint is that he doesn't say anything in any case. You know, the latest controversy is that he says he's more silent than Manmohan Singh. At least Manmohan Singh spoke to the press on the plane to when he traveled abroad. But this man doesn't say anything to anybody. So the pressmen were very upset and very hurt. And normally when the pressmen are taken with the Prime Minister, they have a great time on Air India One. You know, the best alcohol and the best caviar is served on the Air India flight. And he didn't take anybody this time when he went into Brazil. That's a big complaint by the journalists anyway. So what is the situation now with the United States? Here we have to look at Mr. Modi's foreign policy a bit carefully, because he has already spelled out his priorities, not only through the budget, but also in his other statements. What is it that he is looking for from the world? He is not as objective or as benevolent as the rest of India's governments. You know, we'll be friendly, we'll be clear eyes, etc., etc. But he has already outlined what he wants from abroad. What is it that he wants from abroad? First and foremost, he wants FDI, that is foreign direct investment. And he wants it in the insurance sector, he wants it in the defense sector, he is even willing to accept the retail sector. And so, the first and foremost thing that he wants is investment from abroad, including in infrastructure. The second thing that he wants is that he wants to strengthen our defense structure. He wants arms and ammunition from the rest of the world. That is his second need. The third is that he would like a structure in Asia Pacific which will not be hurtful to India, because there is a new Cold War emerging in the Pacific between the Chinese and the Americans. And we have kept clear of both of them when it comes to Asia Pacific. And the solution that Mr. Modi has found is that we will cultivate the Japanese, because the Japanese are not as hurtful as the Americans. And the Chinese don't like the Japanese, that's fine. And therefore he has set his eyes on certain requirements of the country, and he has chosen the kind of partners that he wants, and he is very clear that you must have good relations with the United States, you must have good relations with China, and you must have good relations with Pakistan. So that is where we stand. And does it mean a change in our foreign policy? If you ask me, no. Because even the previous governments were in need of all this. FDI is not invented by Mr. Modi, it was invented by Manmohan Singh or Narasimha Rao in the early 90s. But what restrained them all these years was the fact that, first of all, they had coalition governments where even the leftists were represented. So it was not easy to open out your economy like that. And since you did not have a majority by yourself, it was not easy to change the structure, the economic structure. So coming to the last part of the talk about opportunities. So about business opportunities, now this is the time for India, because we are willing to open out our economy, we are willing to deal with people who are willing to offer us the best terms, and the India will soon be a corporate world, in the sense that it is the corporate interests which are going to determine this. And how the rest of the country will take it, because people often remind us that even though Mr. Modi has a majority in the Lok Sabha, he has only 36% of the vote. So how about the rest of the people? So that is a question which hangs over his head, and that's why probably he doesn't speak, because he wants to do things which will satisfy the 36%, but how about the other 64% of the people? And that is probably a concern. And how that opposition will emerge in the present situation, we don't know. Whether we'll all go by what benefits us, or whether we go by some new kind of theology that we don't know yet. And the emphasis, like I said before also, when Morarji Desai became Prime Minister for the first time, 1977, or when Vajpayee became Prime Minister in 1998 or 1997, all this time, foreign policy did not change at all. There was some emphasis was different, some kind of nuances were there. But basically, the foreign policy was stable and steady. And we made certain adjustments, we established relations with Israel, we became closer to the United States, it is true. But other than that, the foreign policy did not change. And my own prediction is that this government also will not change foreign policy too much. Because it is not very easy to change things dramatically. Because it does not depend only on you. Foreign policy is not determined by us alone, because it is an independent foreign policy, we say. But who are the customers of your foreign policy? That is the other countries. So the other countries should be able to accept the changes that you bring about in your foreign policy. So I can even say that there is nothing called an independent foreign policy, because you have to cater to the needs of the society and how the world changes. But one signal that Prime Minister Modi gave was in the recent discussion on Palestine, which I'm sure all of you have noticed. We have a very old and traditional position on Palestine, starting from 1948. When this whole proposal was made to divide Palestine into Israel and Palestine, two states, India was one of the five countries which voted against that, against the creation of two states. Because our view at that time was that Palestine must remain an undivided state, and Jews and Muslims and Christians should live there together in peace. That was India's wish. And so we voted against the resolution, which was supported by the whole international community. We voted against it. But when it was passed and adopted, we said, certainly we accept that. We recognized both the states, Israel and Palestine. But we said Palestine must also be established, because over the years, Palestine drifted away while Israel came into being as a strong nation. So our position is that both of them should be strong. Israel should feel comfortable. So the Arab countries must recognize Israel, because that's what Israel says. If all Arab countries recognize us, we will remain a peaceful nation. But as long as the Arabs do not recognize us, we will be very aggressive. That's why they have not signed the NPT. Not for our reason, they have decided not to sign the NPT because they think that there is a threat from the Arabs. So what we want is Israel should be recognized, but Israel should live within the borders which were earmarked for them in 1967. Till 1967, Israel had a border which was demarcated by the United Nations. But since 67, they have captured so much of Arab land from which they have not withdrawn. So we can criticize Israel for not withdrawing from the 1967 borders. And we also criticize it for attacking Palestinian land and not allowing the Palestinians to establish their own country. We of course recognize Palestine as a state, but there is no such thing as a Palestinian state except on paper. So our support to Palestine is absolute. But at the same time, we have developed very good relations with Israel. Even in the old days when we did not have an ambassador in Israel, we had good relations with them. They had an office in Mumbai, there was a consulate in Mumbai. There are many, many Jews, including from Kerala, who live in Israel, with whom we have a very good relationship. And after the end of the Cold War, we have also become very close to Israel for other reasons, because of our good relations with the United States, and also because Israel is one country which has the most sophisticated weapons against terrorism, for example. And they are willing to sell it to you because they share a concern about global terrorism with India. So this has been going on simultaneously. We have been speaking against Israel. I have myself spoken in the Security Council so many times criticizing Israel. But Israel never criticized us. They never turned against and said what hypocrites these Indians are. They never said that. They always tolerated the Israeli ambassador always smiled when I was abusing them. So there was no problem. And they understood that in the case of Palestine, India cannot have a different policy. But somehow, somewhere in the government today, there is a desire not to hurt the Israelis. And that is what came up in the Rajya Sabha discussion. Nobody would have noticed if we had a discussion and if we had adopted a resolution. We have adopted hundreds of resolutions against Israel. And even Israel would not have noticed it. But for some reason, I think there was some kind of a communication gap. When our foreign minister stood up and said, I will not allow a debate on this because both of them are our friends. And that is new foreign policy for you. Because we can say both of them are friends, but when a friend does something wrong, you don't hesitate to criticize the friend. That was the policy that we had pursued. So Mr. Modi, who was in Brazil, actually signed a statement by all the BRICS leaders criticizing Israel. But the same resolution he did not allow in the Rajya Sabha, saying that we are friends of both. And this sent out a confused signal. And that has created some confusion in the world as a whole, that India is probably trying to get closer to Israel to the detriment of the interests of Palestine. And that, I think, is a somewhat of a dangerous signal that has gone out. And that is why there is a lot of Palestine movements coming up. In fact, I've been asked to go and inaugurate some pro-Palestine rally at 4:30 this evening. So, because that has been the policy of the people as a whole in India. But except for this, I cannot see any kind of change in the foreign policy of Mr. Modi. He'll be closer to China than the previous government because he trusts them, it looks. Because when he was chief minister of Gujarat, he went several times to China. Basically to understand what the Chinese are doing, what is this Chinese miracle. And he was able to copy a lot of it in Gujarat. And therefore he liked to do that in India without realizing that Chinese, if you embrace the Chinese, it is like the in the Mahabharata, the Dhritarashtra embrace, you know. Sometimes this, you know, so that I see the ascendancy on his part to trust the Chinese, but he'll soon realize, I'm sure, that that is not a very healthy thing to do. But he believes, and rightly so, that there are many things that we can learn from the Chinese on the economic front. So he will be friendlier to China. Japan has never been particularly close to us because Japan hardly had any foreign policy. Japan's foreign policy was American foreign policy all the time. But now since Abe became Prime Minister, there is a tendency on the part of the Japanese to be more aggressive and against the Chinese also. And so apart from the United States, we will have a friendly relationship with China. On Pakistan, of course, there is nothing that any one of us can do. It will be a constant problem for us. The previous government, the present government, everybody will try to make what we call the go the extra mile to be friendly with Pakistan. But the Pakistan, the state is full of contradictions. You know, the army runs the state. Other countries have an army, but this army has a country, they say, as far as Pakistan is concerned. So it's very difficult to have any have a better relationship with Pakistan, but we will try. So on the whole, I would say there will be more continuity than change in our foreign policy. But the good news for all of you, since you are asking me about the opportunities, I would say the corporate world which you represent and the business world that you are interested in is going to determine the future of India's foreign policy and not others, not strategic thinkers. While we are aware of our strategic implications, I think the economic compulsions will be much greater in this government. And if you ask me what is the solution for our problems in our neighborhood, the answer is the same. The moment our neighbors understand that India's economic strength and their stake in it is more important than their political quarrels, then there will be no trouble in our neighborhood. See, India is a name, India is a brand name that they all use. If you go to United States, you will never see a Sri Lankan restaurant, do you? You only see Indian restaurant run by Sri Lankans, because nobody has heard about Sri Lankan food. Pakistani restaurant, there are no Pakistani restaurants in London. There are only India-Pakistan restaurants, because if you say just Pakistan restaurant, nobody will go there. But if you say India-Pakistan, India-Bangladesh, then people go. So it's a brand name which they have used in the past. So why don't they use the brand name in the future? Why does Pakistan go and buy Kenyan tea when Indian tea is available next door, 10 times better quality? So those kind of obsessions which prevent them from cooperating with India, that will disappear the day we are strong enough to make their cooperation with us extremely important for them. So simple as that. So the more growth we have, if you have 10% growth rate, all of them will come up and ask you for favors and you will have a peaceful solution. But if we don't have, if India is found wanting in our economic development or we are seen to be weak, then all these weaker countries will become stronger as far as India is concerned. So the future lies in my view in economics rather than politics. When I was a diplomat, it was more politics than economics. I did not understand the word of economics. But now it is not that. It's completely changed. And the foreign service is also changing. You may have noticed now, people who join the foreign service are mostly technical people. Mostly B.Tech and M.Tech people who join the foreign service and doctors. Not people like me who did English literature. So we were softer than they. And therefore the whole foreign service is changing and our diplomacy is also changing. But I think the predominance will be for business and economics. Maybe I can stop here and then answer questions if you have any. No, but did we create these problems? That is the answer. What did we do to make Chinese claim Arunachal Pradesh? We didn't do anything to them. Why is it that Hafiz Saeed is still living in Pakistan? What could we have done? So my point is that these are all there, these are problems. But these are not problems created by us, therefore we cannot solve them. It has nothing to do with diplomacy. And remember, the purpose of diplomacy is not to solve other people's problems. The civil service, when I speak to civil service aspirants, I keep telling them, there is no difference between the IAS and the IFS. You think there is a big difference? Because the purpose is the same. What is the purpose of the IA? Development of the country. The IFS is also same. Development of the country is our objective. Why? Because you need peace around you. You need calmness around you to develop, that's all. And we should also get the resources we want from abroad. This is the purpose of foreign policy. You may ask, why aren't you solving the problems of the Tamils in Sri Lanka? That's none of my business. But I must make sure that the Tamils in Sri Lanka, that problem does not impinge upon my security and my trade. That's all. So let them continue to claim Arunachal Pradesh for the rest of their lives. We are claiming, we know that it belongs to us. We are negotiating, they themselves are negotiating. But because of the maps left behind by the British, they are claiming this, we had a war, so war is not an option. So what is the option? We can only negotiate. We have the 14th round already. So we have the 15th round, maybe 150th round. But as long as Arunachal Pradesh is in our hands, why should we worry? That's what somebody said about the map. The person in government said, maps don't change borders. Anybody can make any map. So, I mean, but your question, the questions you ask are serious because these are challenges of our diplomacy. We have drawn some red lines. We have said that we will not send troops into Afghanistan, number one. Number two, we will invest as much as possible on the humanitarian side, so that in case we have a friendly government there, India will have a good record. And nobody has attacked our Indian development activities there. They have attacked our diplomats. But the development activities do is we are basically building hospitals and schools. So those have never been attacked by even the Taliban. So now with the Americans leaving at the end of this year, as they claim, if they leave, then there will be chaos because the Taliban will come back. We don't know who the president will be. If Abdullah is president, then perhaps he may be a little more friendly towards India. But if anybody else, or particularly a Taliban dominated comes into Afghanistan, all this money we have invested will also disappear. And we'll have more problems with the Taliban. So there's nothing we can do. So what we are doing is to persuade the Americans and others to settle Afghanistan in a proper fashion, install a proper government and then leave. That is our best bet. But you know what happened in Iraq? Americans left and now hell has broken loose. Similarly, Afghanistan also. When the Russians left, you know, the whole world wanted Russians to leave. But the moment the Russians left, Afghanistan went into chaos. So now when the Americans leave, I don't know what will happen. But if the Taliban comes back to power, then we'll be back in the old game. And then we will have to safeguard our borders with Afghanistan and Pakistan. Because the Taliban will direct their forces against us. And we'll have a bigger job to do. But here again, there is nothing that we have done to create the situation. I was in Vienna when we negotiated what is called the UN Convention Against Corruption. And during those negotiations, this was a big issue. This money stashed abroad by old political leaders and others in anonymous bank accounts. And the two countries which fought against the whole thing was Switzerland and Austria. Because these are the two countries, apart from small island states. But these are the two countries which hold all the black money in the world. And they fought like mad for any measures that would force them to either reveal the extent of their holdings as or any desire on the part of the countries to withdraw that money. They didn't agree. But finally, after many days and months of negotiations, they agreed to one thing. They said, if you can prove to them that any amount of this money has been illegally obtained, they'll give it back to you. But you can imagine how much. How are you going to prove that an Indian who has put money there was illegally obtained? We don't know how much money. Because that is what the Modi government is trying to do. That was the first decision they took. No? But it's 2 months, we haven't heard anything from them yet. So it is going to be a mad race, and you know, they will not easily part with it because their internal laws prohibit the banks from telling you even because they are all numbered accounts, no name on it.